Before going on, it's perhaps necessary just to say that when you have no what you call variance, there is no law of large numbers. It is the law of probability, as everybody is familiar with. So there is no the average wealth of a man walking down Wall Street, for instance. I mean, I'm just quoting that everybody understands. Yes. The importance of having this no variance phenomena.
And even Pareto understood that. Pareto wrote this expression and then apparently he got some flak. So he said, if prefer, it's going to be power law with an exponential term, which makes the variance finite. Yes. Or if you wish, you can have a maximum income. That makes the variance finite. But that was just, facelift. It was nothing. It didn't change reality. But in a real sense, what I was facing, I felt in this field, was people are being too nice about the tools, existing tools, and nobody wanted to say that this was a different kind of randomness. It was not simply a matter of changing it a little bit, of adding corrective terms, of this and that. It was a matter of facing the possibility of something very different. And you mentioned the law of large numbers and central limit theorem. There is a possibility of a central limit theorem with infinite variance. Again, it was at that time total esoterica. More precisely, there are fixed points. The Gaussian is a fixed point. Two Gaussians added, if they're independent, are Gaussian. But Goshi, Polya, Paul Levy had found that there are other distributions which had the same property of fixed point under addition. They call them, Levy called them stable, for the better or worse, that they were possibilities. But Levy viewed them as being exceptional, of no relevance, and so on. I was fortunate in having been Levy's student and having liked this man. On a few occasions, having cornered at lectures, which I was the only student, therefore could not go, and therefore heard things I didn't think I wanted to hear. But I learned a collection of esoterica which might have been totally irrelevant, but which for me became fundamental. So after it became clear that, of course, incomes are not Gaussian, I said, why not try the next simple fixed point? And this was a very, very constant activity in my mind of this emphasis upon fixed points, given that for one reason or another, and I will give other examples, phenomena in outside of, how to say, mainstream physics have no well-defined scale or scales of various kinds. You deal with mixtures, with sums, with this thing. Which distributions are fixed points? And if they are fixed points, let us see whether by any chance the data are actually completely fixed points. So my model of income distribution, which is not something of central significance, not as important by far as my work in prices, but my work was based upon this idea of fixed point as the preferred model for everything. Again, let me remind you that a little bit later, maybe 5 or 10 years later, that was the tack that physics took in condensed matter physics in the theory of critical phenomena in emphasizing fixed points and convergence to them. But for that, I needed to have distributions of these variables, which nobody thought were important. In fact, after computing them, I tried to publish them, and I was left out of court. People say, these things are total esoterica. Who cares how they look like? They're not important. For me, they are tremendously important. In fact, exactly how they looked like. And the income distribution study had many virtues. I don't want to knock it down. It was a necessary preparation for my next stage in prices. But if I think of it retrospectively, I did not become, how to say, respected and known in that profession by this work.